Well, here's a challenge for you. You're about to hear an interview that I conducted with a young woman who was born in Mexico and yet now lives in the United States. However, you only hear the interview. You will not see the video of it. What's going to happen is just before I make a statement or form a question to ask of the young woman, you're going to see a series of images which you are well acquainted with, images that you see, pictures you see within the ULAT that guide you to form the statement or the question that I am about to ask. You'll have a few seconds after you see the pictures to form that statement or to ask that question before you actually hear me asking it or hear me making the statement in the ULAT. See if you can keep up with the pace of the interview. If, however, it's going too quickly, feel free, once you see the images that indicate what I'm about to say, to stop the video at that point, make the statement, ask the question, and then turn the video back on again. Okay, let's see how well you can do. Buenos días, señora.
Buenos días.
¿Cómo está usted?
Estoy bien, gracias. ¿Y usted?
Estoy bien, igualmente. Gracias. Bueno, ¿vive usted en los Estados Unidos?
Yo vivo en los Estados Unidos.
Ok, bien. Y bueno. ¿Vive en el campo, en la ciudad, en un apartamento, en una casa? ¿En qué contexto vive usted?
Vivo en una casa cerca del campo.
Ok, muy bien. ¿Y cómo ocurre? ¿Cómo es posible que usted sepa hablar español?
Yo sé hablar español porque nací en México. Mis papás y una hermana están en México y dos de mis hermanas en Estados Unidos.
Ok, bien. Bueno, ¿está usted casada o tiene hijos o tiene una familia?
Estoy casada y tengo dos hijos, un niño y una niña.
Muy bien. ¿Y tienen ustedes animales domésticos, mascotas?
No.
No, ninguno. Okay.
Ninguno.
Okay. Well, in this first section of the interview, the woman whom I interviewed used the expression cerca de. Cerca de is near. And so when I asked her where she lives, she said, vivo cerca del campo. Sí. So close to the countryside. Then she used the term nací. When I asked how it was that she knew Spanish, she said, nací en México. Nacer, as you may remember from, I think, the interview with Eduardo, nacer is to be born. Nací, notice I'm raising my voice, the stress of my voice at the end of the word nací, that's the characteristic of the past tense, the simple past tense. It is the raising of your voice and the last syllable of the word, generally speaking. And so nací means I was born in Mexico, she said, nací en México. And then she, referring to her family who's still in Mexico, she said, mis papás. Now the word papá, you may have already understood, means father. However, when you talk about father and mother, the term for parents is padres, mis padres, or mis papás. So that would mean parents still live there. And then last of all, she said, I asked about the children she has. She said, tengo un niño y una niña. You know the term, the plural, los niños, for children. Un niño, with an O sound at the end, is the masculine form, so that means a little boy. In una niña would be a little girl. Okay. ¿Lava usted la ropa? ¿Qué hace en la casa?
En la casa normalmente lavo la ropa.
Sí. Sí.
Hago la comida y la cena y cuido a mi hijo y llevo a mi hija a la escuela.
Ok, bien. Y entonces, ¿qué tipo de comida le gusta preparar? ¿Qué suele preparar como comida? ¿Americana, mexicana, otro tipo?
Americana, mexicana y japonesa.
Y japonesa también, ok.
A mis hijos les gusta el arroz blanco con atún y salsa de soya.
Ok. ¿Su esposo es japonés quizá?
No, mi esposo es americano. Mi papá es japonés.
Ok, ok, bien. Next, when I asked her how she spends time during the day, she said, cuido a mi niño. Cuido a mi niño. And cuidar, this is the gesture you'll learn in unit two. Cuido, like you heard from Eduardo also, is to take care of. So cuido a mi niño. So she's speaking specifically about her little boy who's younger, and she takes care of her little boy during the day. Then she said, llevo a mi niña a la escuela. Llevar can mean to carry, but in this context, the idea is to take. Llevo a mi niño a la escuela. So she takes her son to school. And then she said, talking about the different kinds of food that she prepares that her children like. Arroz blanco is white rice, and atún is tuna, and then she said salsa de soya, which would be soy sauce. And then last of all, she used the term, one of us used the term japonés. Japonés is a nationality. Maybe you can guess what it is by listening to it. Japonés. Yeah, it's Japanese. The letter J in Spanish is pronounced kind of like the sound that an angry swan makes. Japonés. And so a man who is Japanese would be, eres japonés. A woman is japonesa. Es japonesa. And the plural is japoneses. But in any case, she explained that her father is japonés, he's Japanese, and therefore but unfortunately she doesn't speak any Japanese, she said. They didn't learn that in the home. ¿Qué le gusta hacer en su tiempo libre?
A mí me gusta leer y tejer.
Y tejer también, ok, bien. ¿Y mira mucho la tele?
Casi no.
¿No? ¿No tiene tiempo? ¿Es por eso o no le interesa?
Me quedo dormida viendo la tele.
¿Y la radio? ¿Tampoco no escucha mucho la radio?
La radio sí. Me gusta escuchar la radio cuando estoy lavando los trastes.
Sí.
Para lavar y bailar.
¿Las noticias o música o qué le gusta escuchar?
Música.
¿Música? ¿Qué tipo? ¿Qué clase?
De todo. Pop. Me gusta, sí. Taylor Swift.
Ok. Ok. Bien. ¿Lee mucho?
Sí, me gusta leer.
¿Y qué clase de literatura le gusta leer?
De todo, contemporánea y autores latinoamericanos. Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. ¿Lee periódico también?
No, casi no.
No, no. I use the expression again, tiempo libre. Tiempo libre, you heard me talk about in previous interviews, is free time. And so I said, ¿qué hace usted en su tiempo libre? ¿Qué hace usted en su tiempo libre? And she said, she used the verb tejer. Now, tejer can mean to knit, to crochet, or to weave. However, I think probably she's talking about knitting. Le gusta tejer. And then, there's one other bit of just a vocabulary word. I use the term el periódico. And if you've not already been introduced to it, I think you are in the course of... probably the next lesson after this one, one point, maybe it's 31, something of that nature. El periódico is the newspaper. ¿Escribe mucha correspondencia? ¿Cartas a la familia en México? ¿Correo electrónico?
Correo electrónico a mis amigos y mi familia en México.
Ok, ok. Bueno, ustedes, bueno, usted va, sí, ciertamente va a trabajar en la computadora durante el resto del día, pero esta noche, por ejemplo, después de acabar con su trabajo, ¿qué es lo que le gustaría hacer? ¿Qué quiere hacer?
Me gustaría tejer en lo que oigo música.
Ajá.
Y a lo mejor tomar una taza de té.
Ajá, ajá.
Y okay. Relajarme.
Ok, bien. Bueno, para comprar comida, ¿a dónde va para comprar comida?
Al supermercado.
Sí, ¿y cómo va al supermercado? ¿A pie, en autobús, en carro, en tren?
¿Cómo? En carro, manejo el carro. En donde vivo no hay autobús.
Ok, ok. ¿Y su familia, salen ustedes a veces al restaurante o al cine?
Antes salíamos al restaurante y al cine.
Antes del COVID, ¿sí?
Antes del COVID, sí.
¿Y cómo viajaban? ¿En carro otra vez?
En carro.
Ok. Bueno, ¿habla usted inglés?
Sí.
¿Cómo aprendió inglés?
Aprendí en la escuela de chiquita.
Ok. ¿A partir de qué edad, más o menos? ¿Recuerda?
Empecé como a los 6 años.
Ok, ok.
Toda la primaria, secundaria y preparatoria.
Ok. ¿Y habla otras lenguas también?
Un poquito, poquito, poquito de francés.
De francés, ok, muy bien. ¿Puede entender otros idiomas? ¿Puede comprender otros idiomas también?
Puedo comprender
un poquito.
Puedo comprender portugués e italiano.
Sí, claro.
Si lo leo o hablan despacio.
Ajá. Pero japonés no, nunca aprendió japonés en casa.
No aprendimos japonés en casa.
Ok. In the last section, she uses the word antes. Antes means before. And then she and I used the verbs, three verbs. Aprender, estudiar, and empezar. Aprender is one of the verbs you just learned. It's this one right here, the idea of learning. And then estudiar, to study. And then last of all, empezar is to begin, to start. Empezar is not one of the verbs you've learned up to this point. You'll be learning a synonym of empezar, which is comenzar, quite soon, but not yet. So in any case, at the end of those verbs, you heard endings that you wouldn't have ever heard before. Usually you'd expect me asking her a question to say, ¿Cómo aprende usted inglés? How do you learn English? However, I had to put it in the past tense because we're talking about when she was in school years ago. And so, ¿cómo aprendió usted inglés? I ask her. That yo ending is the past tense. One of the characteristics of the simple past tense is your voice rises in most cases on the last syllable. So you heard I said aprendió. And she answered, estudié. Notice how her voice goes up at the end, in the last syllable. Yo estudié inglés en la escuela. O aprendí inglés en la escuela. So the reason the verbs sound different is because we're speaking in the past tense. And then she talked about, I started when I was real little. Empecé de chiquita. Chiquita, it means like a little girl. So she started learning English when she was in Mexico as a little girl. Very little girl. She also used another term which means little, but not a little girl, but rather a small quantity of something. You already know poco, right? Mira usted la tele? And you'd answer, sí, veo la tele un poco. Well, even smaller than un poco, which is a little, would be like a tiny bit, is un poquito. And she uses that in talking about how much French she knows. She said, bueno, comprendo francés, o hablo francés, un poquito, un poquito. And then she goes on to say, last of all, that she speaks some maybe she speaks a little bit, but she also can understand to some extent two other languages outside of English and Spanish, Italiano y Portugués, Italian and Portuguese, Italiano y Portugués. Now, why would she be able to understand those languages? Well, there are five languages that are called the Romance languages. I think it has to do more with Roman than Romantic. The idea is that Latin is at the base, the Latin language, which was used in the Roman Empire, is at the base of the foundation of five different languages. So there are five languages that are related to one another. And if you can speak one of them, you can figure out things or understand a little bit or learn more easily the other language. That's why when I learned French, after having studied French for numerous years, I was able to learn Spanish very, very quickly, in just 2 years of study in school, because it's so closely related to French, because they're both part of the Romance languages. Now, what are those five languages? They are French, Spanish, Italian, Portuguese, and the last one you won't guess, probably, it's Romanian. Now, those five languages are all quite related to one another. And that reminds me of a quick story here. Years ago, when we were just about to leave France to move home to the United States, we had we met a Romanian fellow who was actually looking for asylum in Western Europe. He wanted to come and live in France specifically, and he and his wife were traveling around France in their van because the situation for him back in politically was not good back in Romania. He wanted a safer, better place for his family to live, so he's looking for a place to live, and we invited him when we met him to come and stay with us, and they lived with us for the last couple weeks of our time in Europe. And the two of us communicated. He didn't speak French and I didn't speak Romanian, but he had learned a little bit of Italian while traveling through Italy looking for a place to stay, and so I spoke Spanish, and I tried to deform my Spanish just enough so that it would sound like what I thought Italian should sound like. By the way, I had learned the 60 most common verbs in Italian, like you're learning right now in Spanish. And so it did make the job easier for me. In any case, I would deform my Spanish and speak with him, and we understood each other more or less. And so that's the case with this woman, is that because she can speak Spanish, she can understand Italian and Portuguese as well.
Bueno, yo creo que eso es más o menos todo lo que yo quería decir. ¿Qué es lo que va a hacer inmediatamente después de la entrevista? ¿Qué es lo que usted
voy a ir a darle un snack a mi hijo.
Bueno, muchas gracias por su disponibilidad.
Gracias.
Ha sido un placer. Adiós.
Igualmente, hasta luego.